ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय।
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय।
टेक्समेट आदिलीला चैप्टर 4। दिस इज ब्रह्म संहिता। आनंद चिन्मय रस प्रतिभाविता भेस। यू कैन रिपीट आफ्टर मी। यस सर।
आनंद चिन्मय रस प्रतिभाविता भेस।
ताभिर्य एव निज रूपतया कलाभिः।
ताभिर्य एव निज रूपतया कलाभिः।
गोलोक एव निवसति अखिलात्म भूतो।
गोलोक एव निवसति अखिलात्म भूतो।
गोविंदमादि पुरुषं तमहं भजामि।
गोविंदमादि पुरुषं तमहं भजामि।
This is said by Lord Brahma. He is saying, I worship Lord Govinda, the primeval Lord, who resides in his own realm Golok with Radha, who resembles his own spiritual figure, who embodies the ecstatic potency Haladini, and the companions are her confidants, who embody expansions of her bodily form, imbued and permeated with ever blissful spiritual rasa. Yeah, this is from Brahm Samhita, and Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, he quotes Brahm Samhita often in Chaitanya Charitamrita. And why this is quoted is here, because this is chapter's name is Confidential Reason for the Appearance of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So we know about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and there's a famous verse, Namo Mahavadaniyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate. He's a most magnificent avatar. But the question is, why he is most magnificent? Why he is called most magnificent? Ramanuja, he was called as Sanyas Shiromani. He made 6,000 sannyasis, Ramanujacharya, and 60,000 disciples. So many disciples. And regardless of caste, creed, or anything. So, who is more merciful than him? Madhvacharya, he initiated many fishermen into Vedic knowledge. So, and also, even Ramanujacharya, he talked about chanting of holy names. Hare Krishna mantra was not unique, what Mahaprabhu introduced. It was chanted in Madhva Sampradaya. It is chanted. It was chanted in Sri Sampradaya. They still chant that. So what's the unique contribution of Mahaprabhu? Why does Rupa Goswami tell him, Namo Mahavadaniyaya? When holy name was there, devotional principles are there, everything is there. Preaching was there. So the idea is, there are two points why Mahaprabhu is called Namo Mahavadaniyaya. And the first point is because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the first person or avatar of God who has not only talked about love of God, which was also in fact talked before. If you read Divya Prabandhas, South India, Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya, they talk about love. It's all about love. So what's so new and what's so benefactory to humankind? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the first person, a first avatar, who has defined love. There is no avatar who has defined love. There is no powerful personality who has defined love. Mahaprabhu came and he said, well, you all are talking about love. Most of these previous acharyas, they talked about liberation, by the way. Not much about love. Liberation. They focused on liberation. Of course, then they defined liberation in their book as love. But they didn't really talk about love directly. And they didn't said, we deride liberation. They didn't said openly. Mahaprabhu comes, he says, forget about liberation. It is chatu purushartha. Love is pancham purushartha. That's the goal of life. By the way, Bhaktivinoda Thakur writes, love is not the goal of life. Love is a need of life. That's a very to the point explanation. In Bengali, we say, Krishna prem pumartho mahan. So generally, we define it as, Krishna, love of God is goal of life. Prem pum artho. Bhaktivinoda Thakur has a deeper insight. He says, Earth means for somebody in Sanskrit. Earth means money, but earth also means for him. So love is for the soul, for our soul. It's the food of our soul. Without love we cannot live. We should not live without love. So that's what Bhaktivinoda Thakur says. So Mahaprabhu defined love, and he not only defined love, but he gave a scientific explanation of love. There is no scripture in this world who gives a scientific explanation of love. No one. Bible stops at love thy Lord with all thy mind, all thy strength. Was that full? All thy mind, all thy strength, and all thy words? Ten commandments? Just that's it. Stops. Quran doesn't talk really about love. Quran talks about surrender. Islam means surrender. And that's pretty much. Sufism talks about love. You know about Sufism. It's a mystic tradition of Islam. They talk about love, and they talk in deep about love, by the way. There's a Sufi mystic, Rumi. You know about Rumi? He's a poet also. He talks at extents about love, but he doesn't define love. He talks about separation from Allah also. But it's not really defined. It's not this. And of course, he talks about love, but then there's no process to achieve love. A gradual, scientific, step-by-step process that they don't offer. Buddhism doesn't talk about love, of course, because there's no God. But of course, Pure Land Buddhism might talk about love, because they love Amitabh and all those things. And Zen, of course, no chance. It's all about logic, and it's all about koans. Koan? Yeah, koan. So all these things. There's nobody talking about love. There's nobody defining love. This is Mahaprabhu's gift. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu did it through Rupa Goswami. And that is why Rupa Goswami's mantra is, you know that mantra, his mantra? Shri Chaitanya Manovishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale. Rupa Goswami was a person who established the desires of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who penned down the desires of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in this world. He did that. And he started his Nectar of Devotion, which was actually his contribution. And in fact, Rupa Goswami, when Prabhupada was in Radha Damodar temple, Rupa Goswami, he revealed himself to Prabhupada, and he gave an order, translate Nectar of Devotion in English. He told Prabhupada, preach it all over the world. And Nectar of Devotion is a book which defines love. It talks about love. It talks about not only love, but loving reciprocationships. And what Rupa Goswami did, that was a genius. Because previous to Rupa Goswami, there were scriptures talking about drama. Drama? Mm-hmm. You know, you're an artist. Yeah. So those scriptures are called as Natya Shastra. Natya Shastra. Natya means drama and arts, fine arts. So those scriptures are talking about the science of drama. This is 5,000 years back. Or in other words, filmology. You know filmology? This is a new branch, filmology. How to make films. So they teach how to make films. So in films, everything comes. Drama, dance, music, poetry, everything together. That's filmology. And this was not new. In Western world, it's new, but it was 5,000 years back. Bharat Muni, he's the author of Natya Shastra. Bharat Muni is a rishi. And this was revealed to him by Lord Brahma. He gave him this knowledge of drama and music. Because they were Shinarad and all these people, they approached Brahma. And they said, you know, people are getting really bored often on the earth. Without music, drama, you know, you get bored off. He said, they're getting bored off and they're fighting, you know. So Brahma said, okay, I'll send one of my associates, Bharat Muni, and he will teach what's drama. So the point was, Bharat Muni, in his Natya Shastra, he talks about drama, music, dance, and poetry. But he did it in relationship to material sentiments, material love. Boy and a girl, love for nature, it's all material. and he analyzes that. Nobody dared to analyze spiritual love, because spiritual love is considered to be beyond your mind and imagination. No? Achinte khalu ye bhava, aprape mansa saha. Spiritual love is defined, it is said in Upanishads, from where the words recede back. That's spiritual word. Aprape mansa saha, from where the mind turns back. Your mind cannot capture it, your speech cannot. So nobody dared to do that. But Rupa Goswami did. Rupa Goswami applied the same science of drama, music and poetry in spiritual realm. He did that. And that was very unique and very revolutionary, by the way. And so revolutionary that people wanted to kill them. People wanted to kill Narottam Das Thakur. They wanted to kill all these preachers who were preaching all this. Because all these orthodox brahmanas, they said it's blasphemy, it's sacrilege. How can you use mundane drama and poetry to explain spiritual love with God? You're complete nonsense. And there was a revolt. And that's why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is called the most merciful incarnation. Because to do real mercy, to have true mercy on people, it's not easy. Mercy, revolt accompanies mercy. That's the idea. You can't have mercy on people without a revolt. You can't do that. If you want to really be merciful on them. Because you know what? If you want to teach something good, to establish truth and good. What's happening? Okay. To establish truth and good in this material world, that needs courage. And people will try to injure you. We establish truth because nobody likes truth. Isn't it? It said truth is bitter and hard to digest. And Prabhupada said we are Hare Krishna, but we are Harris Krishna. You see, we go on streets and chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. People don't want to listen, they close their doors and then we chant louder, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. So Satyam Param Vijayate. It's not easy to walk on path of truth. In this world, in this age. And if you want to do something good, better be ready to face something. Confucius, he was a philosopher. Confucius and his guru, Lao Tzu. They said, if people laugh at you, be sure that you are speaking the right thing. If people praise you, be sure that you're on the wrong path. Because if you speak the right thing, people criticize Prabhupada left and right. Prabhupada was saying your civilization is cats and dogs. Today we read women should not be independent. Who in Western world, you know, it's they become mad. In fact, there was a revolt in ISKCON in early days when Prabhupada was not giving Brahman initiation to females. Initiation. It was reserved for males and Prabhupada didn't give initiation, Brahman initiation to females. And all these, Yamuna Mataji and all these, they came to Prabhupada and they said, Prabhupada, you should not do like that. You should give Brahman initiation to females, otherwise your ISKCON will split. No females will come. We'll all revolt. You don't, this mentality in Western world like that. And then Prabhupada got this point and then he said, okay, fine. Brahman initiation is never given to females in Vedic culture. That's impossible. Impossible. If you go to India and if you say Mataji is Brahman initiated, they'll just do two things. If it was 100 years back in India, either they will excommunicate that female or they'll burn her and kill her. That's the two things they'll do. It's not possible. It's never heard, it's never to be done. It is blasphemy in Vedic scriptures. But Prabhupada was merciful. He understood Western world cannot understand that. And he hated a compromise, by the way. He didn't compromise, but at this point he compromised. Prabhupada said to his godbrothers when he was coming to Western world, he said, he was discussing with some of his godbrothers, and his godbrothers said, see, Bhakti Siddhanta sent so many disciples to foreign countries to preach and they failed. they failed one after another, one after another. It was not just once. He sent one party before to England and they went to Germany. In fact, Bon Maharaj, these people, they even met Hitler. And they gifted Bhagavad Gita to Hitler. I don't know what happened with them. I don't know what he did with that. Probably nothing. But then he sent another party. And Bhaktisandha said, I'll keep on sending people. No matter we fail, someday I predict one of my disciples will cross the borders of ocean and he'll spread the movement all around the world. And Bhaktisandha was seeing Prabhupada at that time. He predicted. And Prabhupada said to his godbrother, whatever it takes, I'll go to Western world, I'll preach, even if they don't want to follow regulatory principles. I'll ask them to chant holy names. Even if they want to eat, okay, meat, intoxication, no problem. So Prabhupada had that vision. But at the same time, Prabhupada said, I had to walk in the fire of Sankirtan movement. He said this. This is what Prabhupada said. I have to walk in the fire of Sankirtan movement. It was not easy to establish this movement. It was almost impossible at that time. You're in a foreign land. You don't know anything. You're 70 years old. You don't know what to eat, what not to eat. You're about to die and you keep on pushing yourself. So that is Namo Mahavadinaya. Prabhupada had one thing with him. Two things. One is faith in holy name. And one is absolute logic. Prabhupada's godbrothers, they praised Prabhupada, that Prabhupada had good logic. Bhaktisandha praised Prabhupada. That Prabhupada has yukti. You know yukti? Yukti is a Sanskrit word which means the harmony collective, yeah, harmonization. Yukti means to harmonize. So Prabhupada was very expert to harmonize philosophy, to expert to harmonize contradictory points and present them in a logical way, which Western world needed. Western world needed logic, no? An explanation. Prabhupada did that. And why Prabhupada was successful? Because all these boys and girls who came to Prabhupada, they found that he's not just asking us to accept something on belief. I was reading the other day, one philosopher, he was writing that in this Western world, especially in Christianity, he was writing about Christianity, he was saying, in Christianity, we don't need the right belief. We need the right practice. And he was to the point. Because Christianity asks us to believe, right belief. Okay, that's a belief is good. Belief is right. Belief in Jesus. But more than that is practice. And people are recognizing this. By the way, we were talking yesterday. People recognize this. Of course, Indians have no idea what's happening in Christianity. They think it's all good. He pointed out Christianity is not about being something nice. What is projected like that? He said Christianity is all about to understand the mind of Christ. That's what they are understanding this. Well, that's Prabhupada came. The scenario was belief. Prabhupada said, forget it. Prabhupada gave practice. He gave two things. Practice. And people could take, you know, we can follow something. There's a process. And the logic. So click to them. These were intelligent people. Actually, people who joined ISKCON, they were not just hippies. Not just uneducated people loitering on the streets. Very intelligent people joined. Like all these from Michigan, many Maharaj joined, no? All the Jayadvait Maharaj, Satsuru Maharaj, they were very intelligent, they were like educated people, and it clicked to them. Clicked because, there's a belief, there's a practice, there's a logic, what else do you want? That's why Mahaprabhu is Namo Mahavadanya. He gave these three things, all three things. Belief, practice, and logic. It's the most merciful incarnation. That's one point. Another point, why he's most merciful, because this is mentioned in this chapter, because he revealed to us something which was never revealed. Achirat. What's that verse? Achirat. Chiram chirat. That's the word used. Which chiram means long. Chirat means very long. Which was never revealed in history. And what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu revealed? He revealed the love of Srimati Radharani. And nobody knew about that. The conception of God, people know. But the conception of feminine God, that's not known. First of all, you can't put any gender to God all around the world. But here we have a God who is in male form, and then you have a God who is in female form. Now what do you do with this? It goes above head, you know. Krishna and Radha. Of course, there's no difference between Radha and Krishna. There's an expansion. Krishna expands like that. But then on the top of that, you have a love where the devotee is not considering God as God. What do you do with this? It's all different kind of concepts. Nobody can understand this if it is not explained properly. Now, there's no religion which doesn't allow you to look up to God as not being a God. There is awe and reverence in all religions, no? In fact, that's the impetus to serve God, because He's God. Otherwise, why do you serve Him? If you ask any Christian, why do you love Jesus? Just because of resurrection, isn't it? If Jesus would not have resurrected, will you believe in Him? Come on. Why do you believe in Him? He's an ordinary man. But they consider Him as whatever, son or God, whatever, because He resurrected. He came back from death. And that's the impetus. But the idea is, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, no, that's not the impetus. Impetus to serve God is not because He's God. That's not a good idea. Impetus to serve God is just one thing. And that the point is, we want Him to be happy. That's all. So for many people who are not connected to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, for them, at least in India, Krishna is first God, and then he is lovable. First God and then love. But for us, first love and then God. We don't care whether Krishna is God or not. We want to be with Him. We want to serve Him. We want to make Him happy. That's the supreme manifestation of love. Isn't it? If you consider God and then serve Him, then that is something official and that is something business here, isn't it? Anybody can serve God. Anybody, if you understand He's a great man, you'll serve Him. But why would anybody serve a person whom you think, okay, fine. Even if He's not God, I'll keep on serving Him. You see the point? Even if Krishna is not God, I'll keep on serving Him. That's love. That's love. And that is pure love. A mother wants to love her child, even if he's great, even if he's beautiful, even if he's ugly. No, mother doesn't care. Even if my child is ugly, no problem. I'll still love him. Isn't it? Even if the child abuses mother, mother says, no problem. I'll still always give him or her my well wishes. That's love, no? That's pure love. Pure love. Pure love. Any other love doesn't have this kind of thing. They have some wanting from that, some expectation. Mother doesn't have any expectation. Mother doesn't even expect her child to become the greatest man in this world and then I'll love you. Come on, doesn't matter. You might be loitering in the streets, but still you are my darling, no? That's mother, no? And that is why the love between mother and the child, that's praised by many poets and, you know, isn't it? That's something very near to purity. Why? Because mother doesn't expect anything. Similarly, Mahaprabhu came and he explained, pure love with God doesn't expect anything. There's no expectation in that love. You don't even expect God to be God in order to love Him. You see the idea? And that is Vrindavan. That is Braj. That is Srimati Radharani. And that is what is Mahaprabhu's teachings. That is why he's called the most merciful incarnation. That this concept appeals to the soul immediately. This love appeals to the soul. and not the love of being God and then I'll love you. No, it's not the point. In fact, by the way, I was reading, and it's a hot, debatable question in Christianity, that these people, this Peter and this, all these first 12 apostles, Peter and who else were there? I don't know the names. Paul is famous. Yeah, Paul or Saul, whatever.
John.
Yeah, John. Yeah.
Luke.
Huh?
Andy.
Okay. Andy. He was there. Also. Oh, that's why your name is Andy. Okay. So these apostles, they believed in Christ, and Christ is always asking in Bible, "Who am I according to you?" He's always asking, "Who do you say I am?" He's always asking, always. And all of them says, "Yeah, we believe in you, you're Son of God." No? And this is before resurrection, by the way. And it's a big question they're asking. How can they believe in Christ without resurrection? In spite of the fact that modern Christianity is all based and revolves around resurrection.
Yeah.
And these people believe in him as Son of God without resurrection. This means there's something else going on now. Mm-hmm. This means they are understanding him. And not just believing him, they're understanding their teachings. You see, it's a different take on Christianity. Something else is going on. And that's Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He came as, he helped us to understand God and helped us to understand love. And Srimati Radharani, who is a supreme lover of Krishna. And this verse says, Taveriya eva nijaroop taya kalabhi. Srimati Radharani is so special. Even special than Lakshmi. Lakshmi is consort of Vishnu, and Vishnu is expansion of Krishna. Lakshmi is expansion of Radha, and Lakshmi serves the lotus feet of Vishnu. But Radha is so special that Krishna serves the lotus feet of Radha. It's just the opposite. Even God wants to serve the feet of his devotees. No, that's God. God is most humble. No? He wants to serve his devotees. And in fact, there's a famous poet, Jayadev Goswami. He's a poet. He was a devotee. He was writing, he was glorifying Krishna in meditation. He was meditating, he was in a trance. And he saw Krishna touching his head on the feet of Radharani. He saw that. And he said, "It's not possible. I can't write this in my poem. I can't do this." He got a shock, you know. The supreme person is touching his head on the lotus feet of his devotee, Radharani. And she's allowing. That's one thing. She doesn't remove her feet. She allows. And he said, "I can't write it." And then he's like tensed, and he goes in Ganges to take bath. And when he goes from behind, Krishna comes in form of Jayadev Goswami. He comes in his form. He takes his form. He comes. His wife doesn't recognize him, of course. She can't, because Krishna can be more Jayadev Goswami than Jayadev Goswami. He can do that. So she said, "What do you want?" He said, "I remember something." Jayadev Goswami comes, and Krishna comes in form of Jayadev Goswami. He completes that line. And that line is written in Odisha, Bengal, wherever you go. Wherever there is Samadhi of Jayadev Goswami, that line is written. And that line goes like that. Krishna Dehi Pad Pallavam. You heard this? Krishna Dehi Pad Pallavam. Krishna says to Radha, "Radha, give me your lotus feet. I want to adore that." That's Krishna. And this special love, Radha's love is so special it can bind Krishna, can capture Krishna. Radha's love is so special and so heavy that even Krishna bows down to it. He can't take that burden of love. It's so heavy, he can't digest it. He has to bow down in front of that love. And that's Radha's love. And there are many pastimes like that. So once Krishna, he took 400 form. You know that? Narayan form? 400 form. He just stood. And so all these gopis were searching Krishna. And then they came, and Krishna was standing in Narayan form. And they asked Narayan, "Where is my Krishna?" And you know, like four hands, so like with two hands he said like that, and then all gopis were running there, you know. Okay, we have found Krishna, we have asked Narayan, Narayan is God and we have found our Krishna. Of course, Narayan is Krishna himself, but gopis, they don't, in bliss, you know, they forgot Narayan is expansion of Krishna. They're so happy. We found information of Krishna. Okay, fine. Let's go. And in the end, Radharani comes and she asks Narayan, where is Krishna? And Krishna, because Radharani's love is so strong, he couldn't contain himself. And then he revealed, you know, with flute. He couldn't do anything in front of Radha's love. That's love. That is Mahaprabhu's most merciful contribution. It's the most munificent avatar. He is the first avatar who is saying, God is not God, love is God. Love is higher than God. Nobody said this. In Vrindavan, if you go, Krishna is not supreme, Radha is not supreme, love is supreme. Love reigns. Love rules in Vrindavan. Everybody knows in Vrindavan. They talk about this. It's not God. It's not God. He is a king, love is a king, love is a queen. All acharyas in the books, they write this. Love rules. This is unique contribution. That's why we say Namo Mahavadanya. It's not easy. And Prabodhananda Saraswati, and the unique thing is about Mahaprabhu, why he's called most merciful? Because he gave all these lofty concepts to useless people like us. Such high concepts, which even Paramahamsas cannot think about it. And Mahaprabhu comes, hey, come on. You drug addict, you take this knowledge. It was never thought like that. And Prabodhananda Saraswati writes in his book, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave spiritual principles and the highest spiritual principles to people who never even heard the word religion. They never even heard, they never even smelled, they don't. We all people like that, no? We didn't know what is religion. Even now we don't know, by the way. We have to be trained in religion. And that's a seminar I'm giving, Vedic education. We have to be trained. Even now we don't know, but Mahaprabhu comes and he says, okay, take it. Take it. With a risk that we might not understand anything. Highest thing to lowest person. That's an act of mercy, no? Isn't it?
What was that you said? Highest.
Highest principles to lowest men. That's a real act of mercy, no? And why? Because to do this, it's very difficult. To teach higher principles to people who have intelligence, that's easy. But to teach the highest principles to people who have no brain at all, that's impossible. You have to work hard for that, isn't it? A teacher has... If in the class everybody is intelligent, teacher doesn't have to work hard. If everybody are dull students, teacher has to work hard to present in such a way to make them understand, no? Isn't it? So that's why mercy also is accompanied by efforts, with efforts. You can't have mercy on anybody without putting efforts. You can't say, okay, I bless you. No, it doesn't work. That's modern religion. No, you have to work hard to bless them. Something you have to do. That's what Prabhupada wrote books night after night after night after night after night. And Prabhupada says, this is my mercy. I worked hard. And that is why it is said, mercy is accompanied by two brothers or two sisters or two brothers. One brother, one sister. And the brother is... The name of the brother is revolt, and the name of the sister is efforts. That's all. It comes with it. If you don't have these, you can't have mercy. You can't just speak, you know. You can't just think, oh, I have mercy on you. It's not just, this thinking is Western idea, no? It's all Western idea. Don't do anything, just speak and smile and go and everything is done, you know. It's all Western idea. It's all laziness. It's all...
Entitlement.
Entitlement. Yeah, something like that, yeah. It's all, they're all lazy. It's not like that. You have to work hard to help somebody. To lift somebody from down, it's not easy. It's not easy. That's why Bhakti Santa said, to make one devotee, you have to shed 200 gallons of blood. It's not easy to make people devotees. You can tell them, you can speak to them, but to raise their consciousness, you need to be with them, you have to train them, you have to guide them, you have to burn your blood. And then there are questions, you know, you have to hear to them, to solve them, and their nonsense you have to hear. Isn't it? When people come, you know, they say, yeah, this and that. But you have to hear patiently what to do. Because if you don't hear them, they don't hear. You have to reciprocate, no? So it takes a lot of, it takes a toll, you know. It's a burden. In fact, who was this? Saint Francis of Assisi, you know this? You know him?
Yes.
He made his order in Christianity. Mm-hmm. So there were around 1,000 people under him getting trained. So once he left that, he just went off. He just said, I get frustrated, you know. He appointed his junior to take care of them. And he went, you know, in some mountains. And after 1 month, a devotee comes to him and he said, you know, you need to come back because that devotee is dead. He said, what happened? He said he couldn't take the pressure of leading them to the path of purity. You can lead anybody and you can just manage. Management is different, leading is different, you know. Leading on the path of purity, he couldn't do that. He couldn't help them. He got so much stressed, he left his body. And we all know as preachers, and especially, like, I'm also helping people, devotees, like, so I'm running 5 to 6 centers and Gurukul and this and that. And so many people you have to guide, and it's a burden and stress. If you really want to help them, it's a stress because you have to think about the benefit. You have to think some practical solution which can help them, isn't it? Now they come with a problem, and you can always say chant Hare Krishna and everything is happy, will be good, you know. Yeah, read Prabhupada, books. Be sincere, chant Hare Krishna. That's the universal solution. That doesn't work.
Surrender.
Yeah. It's not a good idea. If somebody comes with a problem, you have to think how to practically help them, to give them a practical solution. That's your contribution. Otherwise, any fool can say like that. Mm-hmm. Surrender, chant, Hare Krishna, everything is nice. It's a problem. That is why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Namo Mahavataniyaya. Highest principles to lowest man. And he worked hard. Mahaprabhu worked hard means his disciples worked very hard. Nana Shastra Vichara Naika Nipunau. These Goswamis, they were day and night, they were reading scriptures, many scriptures, and taking the essence and writing. And by the way, at that time it was very difficult to read many scriptures. First of all, there's no internet, there's no folio. You imagine, you know, that time. And even to get those scriptures and to have them at one place, that was almost impossible. So you have to get books of Madhvacharya, Ramanuja from South India, and all those, you know, you have to collect all those books at that time. There's no transport and there's nothing. People are going, taking months and bringing one book. Mm-hmm. And then you have to copy it, otherwise it will spoil, and that's written on leaves. What to do? And then you have to read all of them. Then you have to, on the leaves you have to write and you have to store them. It was a big job, it was almost impossible, but they were doing that. It was a lot of effort for the benefit of humankind. This is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Any questions now? I'll just stop here on this verse, but any questions? You can keep on reading, it's so nice. Anything you want to ask? Anybody?
What is, those efforts were made in back then, and then you know, Prabhupada and his disciples had this big push, establishing the temples, getting the books printed.
Mm.
So what is the next big effort that's needed?
Yeah, actually it is said there were two waves, big waves. First was Sankirtan movement, first wave. The next wave was temples. Mm. And the third wave should come, and it's about to come. That's Varnashram. That's the third wave. Sankirtan, temples, and the next wave is in ISKCON is Varnashram. So these are the efforts, these are like big paradigm shift. And that's why like you're also interested in Varnashram, we are also interested. Without that, we can't move.
Yeah.
It's impossible to move.
Things are very stifling.
Yeah, it's impossible to maintain the society, help people.
Things are going kind of backwards.
Yeah, we're going backwards, yeah. Unless it gets finished. It's urgency to do something with Varnashram. People are recognizing actually. All over the like many, of course, in America, they're not, GBC is not giving much. I have no idea. But back in India, they are recognizing all over the China and many sannyasis. We are talking about that. Some people are doing, like Bhakti Vikas Maharaj, I'm also doing under his guidance something. Bhakti Raghav Maharaj, he's doing Varnashram. Who else is doing? Shivra Maharaj, he opened that. Hungry?
Oh, yeah, they have. Definitely in the Western world, they're doing.
Yeah, they are doing. And yes, so we asked them, and they said in another 15 years, they'll be self sufficient.
15 years.
Yeah, why 15 years? Because self sufficiency means they'll make all the instruments,
yeah.
Like everything, even a nib. Now we have to buy a pen, you know, something,
yeah,
but
yeah.
Everything. So that's not a big thing, 15 years, if they are. Fully self-sufficient. So they are going ahead. We are all trying to do that, and that's what we have to do. We have to think about it, how to do it. But for that, like you said, first we need to train ourselves in culture.
Mm-hmm.
We need to imbibe the culture and the values.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise we'll not be able to do it. Because the backbone of Varnashram is culture.
Yeah.
And education. Which I'm going to talk about. Otherwise, you can't do it.
This devotee, we started talking at Varnashram. I don't like the conversation normally because it's always about like cows and farms.
Yeah.
Which is like, it's like sahaja.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, yeah.
And then one devotee gave me the word for it. He said, there's like a dharma which is more fundamental. There's samanya dharma. Those are like basic principles which no matter who you are,
You have to follow.
Human being, then you're able to be honest, truthful, straightforward, a couple other simple things.
Yeah.
And that's where we have to start the conversation.
Yeah, you're right.
If we're trying to impose these kind of artificial external things, okay, I'm this caste, you're this caste, you do this.
Yeah, it doesn't come, yeah.
But those basic principles of communicating and living with integrity.
Nothing works. Yeah.
It's just another.
You're right. That's what now we have to come up with in ISKCON. What do you want to ask, Guru?
Well, you talked about the blood it takes to make a devotee and the way one has to conduct themselves because people are coming from all different places.
Yeah.
And like, my struggle. Is like I myself, it's so much blood just to behave, you know, in among Vaishnavas. And I can see seniors, I can see that they take the step for me by conducting themselves in a way that helps me come up.
Mm.
Like specifically it's toward me, I can see it when it happens.
Mm.
So, in terms of being able to do that for another person, it's one wonders, like, it just seems very difficult. Like, I can't.
So you can't figure out why that
like,
person
I can't
is taking those
there's,
steps.
There's like the simple, like, what we're really asking is for people to like change their culture, their internal culture.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we're asking of ourselves every day.
Yeah.
And it just entails so much. It's like a... So
what's the problem there? Like, I can't figure out
just
the
problem there is... I'm only recently coming... Like, I was part of... For my longest time, was just chant Hare Krishna. Cause, just surrender because, you know, basically it's hopeless. But it's only recently at that time realizing, you know, that chanting Hare Krishna is not enough.
Okay. Yeah. But,
I don't know. It just seems it's a lot at once. Like.
No, it's not a lot at once. It is. Krishna says, Susukham kartam avyayam. Krishna says this process is blissful. It might be a lot, but it is blissful, but it should be gradual. It should be gradual. Slowly and steadily we imbibe these qualities, we follow these things, and we feel happy, and that's why we continue, isn't it? So Prabhupada says that, Prabhupada said about this dress, tilak and dhoti, Prabhupada says that you are looking like a Vaikuntha man. This is such a nice dress. See this dress, pants and shirt. It's not good now, isn't it? It's not. It doesn't look so goodness as this dress looks. Do you agree, Andy?
Yes.
Isn't it? You see?
It's hard to sit.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So, it might be a little difficult, I can understand. Change, every change is difficult, isn't it?
Mm.
Every change. Like suppose if you were in material life and you get married now.
Yeah.
That's a big change in your life, and that's difficult. You will find difficulty, you know. Another person comes in your life to do job, and then he will come and tell you, my God, it's so difficult. Why? Well, it's a change. Life means change, and change means difficulty. Even if you don't want a change, still change will come. If you are here, if you are there, you can't help it out. This word means change, and change means difficulty. That is why, you know what, this is whole Western way of thinking. What we carry, okay, fine, life will be so nice and everything will be good and this and that. And when people face difficulties in real life, challenge they have to face, then either they break down, they freak out, they take drugs. But in our culture, we train people, don't run from difficulties. Difficulties is a part of life. That's how world is designed. So, don't get disturbed. There or here, change will happen. Try to imbibe that for elevating your soul, for making your soul pure. Try to understand and use that change to advance and not to get disturbed.
Mm.
You see the point?
Mm.
And then there's no problem because we understand. You know. We are not in a utopia that here there's so much change and this and that, I have to do so many things and material world it'll be so nice. No, it'll not continue the same thing. Your life will change. Definitely. Things will change. Isn't it? Am I right or not?
Mm.
So you can't run away from this. Better, it is said, if you face a lion, don't run away. If suppose you're walking in a street and a lion comes, you turn and there's a lion. And you meet face to face. So what do? Don't run away. If you run away, you're dead for sure. If you turn and go, lion will catch you. You can't just do anything. By the time you turn, you are out. So don't fight. That's the only solution. You might win. And in India, this happened. One person, he was just in forest and he went like to cut woods and a lion came. And he knew, if I run away, nothing is going to happen. So what he did, there's a lion like roared and he, I don't know, somehow out of fear, he just put his hand in his mouth. The full hand. And like, of course his hand got damaged. But then the lion's throat got choked. He died. He got saved. He saved himself. And that is a rule in management, by the way. In management, there's a rule in management. Good managers should never turn their backs on problems. And never procrastinate in solving problems. Face head on. With problems, always, as soon as possible, solve it. Otherwise, even in this, if you have kurta, if this small tear, here, you know what will happen? Shh.
Yes.
That's life all about. We are not trained to face things.
Right.
We are not trained to get challenges. We are actually all cowards. This Western society has made us like that. No.
Mm-hmm.
Talking about all these lofty concepts, love, be nice, be that. What is this,
Peace.
Peace.
Nobody even bothers with love anymore.
Yeah.
Just peace.
This is all right, but there's another aspect of life also, isn't it? That is not given to us. That's what Vedic culture helps us to go along.
That's an excellent
point. Is that good? Is that, it makes sense to you?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, no problems.
When we come to devotional life, this is what most devotees, they feel this sense of relief for about 6 months. Like, okay, I don't have to do anything else anymore.
Yeah.
I don't have to think anymore. I just, now I chant Hare Krishna, and I read this book, and everything will be fine.
Mm.
But then after about 6 months to a year, they realize that still all the problems are there.
Yeah, you're
still,
right.
Everything is there. Still all the challenges. And it frustrates them, they lose their faith, because they didn't actually understand what was to be gained through the process.
Yeah, actually, Prabhupada defines peace in a very different way. Modern definition of peace is that everybody will be nice to me, even though I am not nice to them. They should be nice to me, and it will be nice. I'll be peaceful. Okay? This is modern definition. I'll try to be nice, but I expect them to be nice to me. And that's it. But Prabhupada defines peace as peace. Who can be peaceful? Whose goal is fixed? Prabhupada says, because of lack of goal, people are frustrated. No, Bhagavad Gita?
66.
See that? So Prabhupada defines peace whose goal is, when your goal is fixed, you are peaceful. Because you know what you have to do in life. And that's what we have to tell devotees. When you're coming in this movement, there is a goal to fulfill. There's a mission. And you give this sense of goal and mission to that. It's not just information, a sense to them, and they'll be peaceful. Without that, if we want to make adjustments, you know, doesn't work. Mind doesn't work like that. So mind is peaceful if you have a goal. That's what, so you have to have a goal in your mind. You have to understand what I'm doing here. What's my mission? What is this all about? I'm contributing something. I'm contributing in a mission which can save this world. And even a drop counts. Even a drop counts. And if you have this sense, if you have this broad sense, you see, if you are looking at a holistic picture and not just a segment, and in that segment only we are there, then there's a problem. You see? And then we can go a whole life. We can be happy. You got the point? That's how it works. Okay. That's it. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki
jai. His grace.